talked about the difference in bans from Cold. They took what I said into account. They ghosted the stream. Goddamn ghosters. And no, but they actually do. ECX bans Ophelia, and now that leaves Cold with a hero to pick. And now ECX doesn't have one of those first pick incredibly strong heroes to pick straight away. And not only that, they also left both Midas and Behemoth open, so if ECX decides to pick either of them, Cole will get the other one. So this is a really interesting start. They're going to pick Midas here, 100%. See? And just like that, they now get two heroes that they want instead of one, which is what I talked about the other two games. I'm not sure why they drafted the way they did, but they ended up winning the second game quite remarkably, and now we have a very strong start here in the first game.
Yeah. Being on that Legion side, it definitely... See, so I find it interesting, you know, when we do the roles initially, I feel like a lot more teams choose Hellborn. What is your logic? What side do you like to choose?
I like Hellborn a lot because I feel like I can read more of what they want to do when they pick their first hero. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I personally like Hellborn, but I don't really care about either side. There is some teams that I would rather have certain side versus, but I'm not obviously going to say that.
Okay.
I think it's just a factor of knowing what the enemy team wants. Like, when they pick these first two heroes, Lord Salforest and Midas, they've already picked their jungler and offlane, right?
Yeah.
So ECX is completely aware of what Cole wants to do. Now they know that they only need a mid hero or an offlane, if Midas is going to be mid, of course. And they know that they need a carry. So it's kind of like on paper what they want to do. So.
Okay.
But it's from captain to captain, I think. Yeah. Well, ECX, free comfort heroes.
Yeah, that prisoner, the third pick there, so Matthias will end up playing that. Tankafed on Parasite and Zane on that Behemoth right here. So, but yeah, Complexity getting what you got on Lord Salforest, most likely. So they got their jungler taken care of. Now the banning phase, neither team has that carry yet, so I kind of wonder if that's going to be involved here probably. For both the sides, taking away at least one of the potent carries. There's Wilds. They did ban Wilds, that's right. So
Sandwraith got through, actually.
He did for now.
I honestly think Sandwraith would be perfect here for Cole.
So they
but we'll
ban.
See what they end up doing. No, they should not. I would expect ECX to ban out heroes that like Ogi and Malakin again. But unless they want to get rid of like good mid heroes, this is a tough one. I'm not really sure because this is not like the first three picks you usually see in Cole. Like Lord Salforest, Midas, and Glacius. They recently started playing Salforest because it was in a scrim I played against them. Like, and I was like, it really sucks right now with the four bans when we play each other as teams because we always ban the same four heroes, and I always get Salforest. I told him. And he's like, well, I don't care about Salforest. And then I went 20 kills in that game, and after the game he whispers me, oh, Salforest is OP. And now they started playing it. So I honestly have never seen Wig in a tournament game play the hero. So it's going to be interesting what they're going to do.
Huh. Yeah, no, now that you mention that, I'm trying to recall. I got to think they've done it. Man, really?
Nope. Never in a tournament game. In a scrim, yes, not in a tournament game.
Maybe not, yeah. That's interesting. Well, picking it up then and realizing the true power. You know what I was
and
hearing
Ogi
about?
Was banned.
What's up? Ogi? Oh, Ogi, yeah. Ogi got banned, yeah.
Sorry, I interrupted.
Well, I was going to say, I heard about this idea of gentleman's bans coming out. And when I heard it was going to be happening today, I was surprised to see it was Salomon. If anything, I would have expected Lord Salforest because I know the talk about him. As
Salomon is way more. It's way stronger than Salforest. Like, Salforest is a very strong hero, but Salomon is even worse. Like, you know, there's a reason we ban Arachnet, Warbeast, Ophelia, and stuff like that as the blind man instead of Salforest, because those heroes still have more impact than a Salforest does. And a Salomon simply just gets 800 GPM no matter what you do, presses R, has a true damage mock, jumps into your team, presses R when he's low, and boom, you just five heroes just died.
The gist of it is that, yeah.
Yeah, that's the gist of it. It's how it feels like. And yeah, Imbaboy bans out to Sandra, so really good there. Mm-hmm. Really, really good. Because that's definitely the hero they would have picked up.
Yeah, so as expected, pretty carry heavy ban. Tundra, the only different one there.
Yeah, I would. I think they. I'm not sure if they should dodge or fight them mid, because they could pick a hero here that could allow them to fight mid, or they could dodge it with a bubbles. But I'm trying to think. It's so hard going up against a Behemoth Prisoner Parasite Lane mid. So I think Bubbles would be fine. Problem with Bubbles is that they will lack damage a lot. Silhouette. Yeah, Silhouette I'm not surprised about. But like for mid lane, like it's really hard for them to pick a hero that can deal with a Behemoth Parasite Prisoner. Because all of those heroes can be mid, and then there's a support on top of it. So this is going to be a tough choice for them. Miraxis? Yeah, Miraxis could make sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. I still think he dies, though. You know, Sane leaves his lane. Everyone knows that. That's why he doesn't die. He knows exactly when to leave the lane, and then he doesn't come back, and he sits in other lanes. Mm-hmm. And I feel like even a Miraxis will have problems mid.
Well, so you don't think it's going to be a Midas mid?
No, I don't think it should be, because he will get wrecked by a Prisoner and the W. Because it is, you know, the increased duration on W and Prisoner, right? You got to hit it twice.
Uh-huh.
3, 5, 7, 9 seconds. So he can't blink for 9 seconds at max level unless he hits it. And in lane, it will be 3 seconds, because he won't skill it up more than once, I'm guessing. But I still don't see Midas being able to lane there very well. But if they have a Miraxis-Midas combination, I think you're right, and I think they'll put Midas mid and Miraxis off lane for sure. Oh, Rhapsody. Wonder what carry they want. There's not a lot of Imbaboy carries left.
Clanks.
Clanks, Dark Lady comes to mind. Puppet. Miraxis. Like Google Miraxis. Okay. I think you're right about this. I think it's a Midas mid and Miraxis off lane.
Fuzzy Sloth, no one to play a very strong Midas.
Midas. Yep.
Towards that. All right, but yeah, they're gonna have to choose their carry now. Not too much extra time ultimately left, so yeah, a couple of that we listed there. Puppet, Clanks mentioned. So Dark Lady, Nitro.
They want. Oh, Nitro! That. Please, no Nitro. That hero is such a pain to play against.
I know. Should go Nitro here.
Oh, Breaky. Yeah, I would love to tell you a secret, but I'm going to have to do that off stream.
Oh, wow.
Scout again. Scout. Okay.
So there's interesting. No Mage being here, but I guess Silhouette, too, it's not bad against.
No, it's really good against Silhouette, too. Yeah. I just didn't know they valued him so high.
Yeah, they won the first game with it, and again, a lot of that... Maybe it wasn't 100% the scout by any means, but he was free farming, and he definitely showed that he had a huge impact there. It was an aggressive carry, too. It wasn't a sit-back farm carry, so.
Well, it looks like we're both wrong, by the way. Oscar is on Midas.
Okay. They do swap it up.
But maybe it's the scout versus Midas combination that they're really into, you know? It could be something like about that as well. Like, you know, like you saw how they shut down the Midas. Maybe it's the same thing. That they feel like Scout is not only good against Silhouette and Magepain, but it's also very good against Midas in lane with the silence and the support. Could also be a reason, but I'm going to ask him about after the cycle's over. He obviously won't tell me before the finals, but he should tell me after.
If they're in the finals, that is.
Yeah, no, but I mean, like regardless, he will tell me
true.
After the cycle's over.
That's a good point. All right, ACX, good to go, so... As complexity is, we'll be good to get officially started with game number 3 here. Again, to determine who's going to the grand finals to play Sync shortly after. So, both teams, pretty comfortable lineups here. Nothing as odd as it sounds, though. And the one thing you were mentioning, again, Lord Self Force for complexity. I guess they haven't been too fond of the hero or haven't been playing it, so.
No, but he's been playing it in TMM a lot. He's been practicing it. So I believe it'll be fast jungling, and I would reckon he's been watching replays of other players as well.
Well, yeah, I mean that's what I was gonna bring up because we did mention. I mean, and I think it is safe that Tank Effect, yeah, it showed a little bit of the fact that his GPM was where it was, just something was off. It really seemed like that maybe he wasn't the most experienced. Like, how different is it though than at Ophelia, Parasite? Like, what is it, like what makes it so different?
You take so much space. You constantly farm, and players like Tanka, who sets up plays in open space, is not used to taking that much space. Like, I love to farm. I think everyone knows that. So playing a hero that just constantly takes creep waves, constantly takes stacks, constantly takes farm, but is active at the same time, fits me a lot better than fits Tanka, I think.
Okay.
So I think Tanker is better than me at opening up space, and I'm better at farming, which both has its ups and downs, obviously. So I think he just hasn't played it, but he would definitely be up there if he just placed the hero. So, well, I mean, it's not like he played it bad. He was just a little. We saw the inexperience when it came to the farming in the jungle.
It's not the minion based jungler like those.
No,
I think that obviously changes it up as well. Soft Force reminds me more of a Legionnaire even. Especially, or Amun-Ra, which actually we have been seeing a little bit of kind of trickle in. You know, you want to
in a way.
So, Amun-Ra.
They also have a kind of, they have a little bit of a different play style, though. You know, like Legionnaire goes for an important target on initiation, and then that's it. That's it. That's his job. He blinks in. He makes sure he gets the target with the Shrunken, and then he keeps up and hopes for a second taunt. Soft Forest's job is to kill all the low HP targets. Like, you put your ulti on a main target that you want your team to kill while you kill their supports.
Yeah.
At least that's how we played, and most Soft Forest players.
I was referring more to the jungling execution.
Oh, you mean the jungling aspect? Yeah. Sure, yeah.
Straight up jungling.
Legio stacks a lot and kill stacks, and so does Soft Forest, but I honestly have no idea how to jungle raw. I've done it a couple times in practice mode, and I even had to ask Twitch chat how to do it, which is never a good thing. But they taught me how to get level 6 by 5 minutes at least, so it's not terrible, but I've seen real jungle raw players do it in 4 and earlier, so I think I have a way to, a little bit to learn.
Yeah, there's a, like I said, we saw him several times, a couple different teams. What was it, Denver Pro, I think, played it a couple times, and then...
Yeah, I think so.
Not the best, whatever player that is. As funny as the name is, he actually played it a couple times over there, and it was pretty impressive.
Low picks.
Yeah.
It's low picks, yeah.
Complexity lost one of their games to, who was that? That was group standings. Was that to Pine? Yeah, I think that might have been in the Pine match up there.
So yeah, I think so. They were so close of choking in the group stage. Would have been so nice, but
yeah.
Nope.
Yeah, and I understand why you say that, because, yeah, obviously that would have really set you guys up nicely going into the final cycle. So,
yeah, if they didn't make top 4, we would have been like 500 points ahead, even if we placed top 3. Mm-hmm. Now I have to hope that ECX win. But even then, as long as we win the cycle, which I hope we will,
yes,
we will still be, I think we're...
If you win the cycle,
we have the math. Yeah, we have the math written down.
If you win the cycle, you control your own destiny. That's how I like to put it. Like, if you
yes.
finish higher than Complexity next cycle, then you're good. It's the same thing for
exactly.
Complexity, however, if they win. You know, obviously, if they finish higher than you, then they win. So that's the best way to look at it, I think. All right. Here we go, though. Game number 3 finally commencing here. And into the lanes we go. Looks like Behemoth, sure enough, heading towards bottom initially. You got... nobody going towards bottom yet. Yeah, okay, Silhouette is heading down here now.
Maybe Sane will be top again. Just wait for a kill. Why is Fussy offlane?
Oh, yeah. They're going aggressive again?
Wait, are they aggressive?
Well, Glacius is heading up here, too.
Why?
Scout? Maybe they don't like the scout.
But... But this is half as strong of a lane as Rhapsody Drunken is. As a long lane, like in a straight up 1v, like 2v2 mid, it's fine, but they don't have a dance floor to man up on. They don't have any heals. They have a freeze that he has to save. He has to save it for Parasite or they're going to lose the lane. So freeze can never be used offensively. He has to save it for Parasite every time, which means he has no ability to use it offensively against their lane. Mm-hmm. So I really dislike this long lane, but then again, I was wrong last game, and they ended up winning that game, so let's see if I'm wrong again.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, just put it out, though. I mean, remember what happened last time they did this? They did get bloodlusted, so
yeah,
they're going to definitely be a little more cautious at this time, I'm sure.
Well, Sane is here this time, bottom lane, and of course, Sane will maximum get a 200 GPM down here against Silhouette.
Yep. So they definitely see him now, so they feel a lot more comfortable at the top side. So yeah, with Rhapsody being here in the scout.
Yeah, I mean, on paper, Complexity farms has a faster jungler, and they win mid and they win bottom. So they technically win free lanes. But as long as scout gets 300 or 350 up top, it won't matter. So we'll see how they're able to do up there. But on paper, both Midas should beat Prisoner and Silhouette should beat Behemoth. So it's not really bad. It just depends on how much they feed top.
Yeah.
But we'll see.
Yeah, that's the execution comes into play. You see Rhapsody
already
doing the pull or the stack even. Now he's going to pull it at the 115 or so mark. So going to get the early pull here, try to get the lane position back. Right now in favor of Complexity, of course. So Zalforest, definitely want to keep an eye on what you got here this game and again see his progress. So maybe not the most experience on it in the tournament matches at least.
No, I'm gonna keep an eye and see what kind of rotation he does. He's already done different than me, so I'm curious what he's about to do. He has to pull, which I usually don't have the luxury of having, so we'll see.
Because it would usually be blocked.
Chroma would usually have it.
Okay.
When we use Zalforest, we usually have a short lane double.
Gotcha. Stacks it there.
Well, free tip for enemy teams. Woo. Oh, haste bottom. He didn't actually stack the Arcam. Why would he not do that? I just noticed. I was looking at him and I was like, oh.
He wasn't doing that either, yeah. Did he have to catch it, right? Mistake. Yeah.
Yeah, he does. And it was off cooldown.
Yeah.
So, Rhapsody's mid now, though, so it looks like they're leaving Scout top alone. He's 2 AGPM right now.
Oh, do they have any Dust or anything like that right now? No, they don't.
No.
Dust or Revel.
Yeah. Sadly, he's going to miss out on the haste here now. And Rhapsody is hasting bottom straight away to try and kill the Silhouette. He must have called. Silhouette cannot die here. That would be so bad. Oh, there's the Parasite too. Okay, so they're going aggressive long lane now. So their way of responding to this long lane from Raxus Glacius is just keeping Scout top and long lane tri-lane. Mm-hmm. Which is interesting because that removes the fact of the 2 lanes, 1 on paper.
Nope, they're going, but the Fissure's on the wrong side. And he's going to go over into the Minotaur though, so maybe this could work out actually.
He's going to kill Parasite.
Formless, go for the turn kill. No, he can't get it in time. He does get it eventually, but Bloodlust in favor of Nier there. Free CX, so that actually worked out despite the Fissure. Maybe that was the plan.
Maybe.
Right there. Haste rune, yeah, that's true.
Well, I don't want to be rude here, but I could just write that you should have stacked the Heart Camp and ran for the bottom rune in 2 minutes, which you should always do as a Zalforest jungle. So he can't really complain, because that was his haste.
Oh, yeah, no, it's if you're going to complain about runes and what spawns for them, then you got to make sure
you're
under control.
Yeah, look what Nier wrote. Because that's what you do. You stack the hard camp, you stack the medium, and pull is available, then you run for the bottom rune, because otherwise, they can get a haste, and that's what happened.
Yeah.
Sorry, Wig, but no complaining allowed here.
See right there, he's got a 4-minute rune, and actually, Behemoth steals it in front of him, so... Good rune control again. Definitely in favor of VCX here. In fact, regen on Prisoner, and he's headed towards top, but obviously there's a ward of sight here, so yeah, he figures, okay, it's not worth it. Turns back mid. Gonna continue this farm here. How is that mid breaking down? 22-4 Midas, Prisoner 23-1, so actually very even.
Yeah, I thought Midas won this in a 1v1, but looks like I'm wrong or someone's playing bad. Let's just say that I'm wrong. I'm gonna ask Mickey actually.
Let me nice read this guy.
Let me ask Mickey here.
Midas, he's gonna be fine in the end.
All right, I wrote to Mickey and I will see what he says.
Mickey,
let the master choose. Yep.
He'll decide. There's a stealth hunter. Oh, he just used it just before, so Zalforest has no clue here. I don't think so, at least. But yeah, he's actually gonna die. So he has to just continue the farming instead.
Yeah.
He could have actually, that would have been interesting if he actually blocked one of the camps right there right at the spawn mark. That could have hurt Zalforest, but nope, he's farming it himself.
Yeah, no, he's just going to apply pressure to bottom and mid, and Midas is actually farming his camp here. A little bit afraid to go mid right now. Nothing tank I can do here. Should just run back and farm the medium, I think.
Yeah.
This is good, though, because they're going to be able to control both runes here. Like, next rune will be taken by Tanka, and then for top lane it will be taken by the mid lane. So, this is looking kind of fine. I don't know, like, look at Scout. He has not dropped a single penny of GPM since they rotated.
Oh, no.
He was 290. He was 290, and now he's 290. And Meraxis, he's 260. So, they're not actually getting ahead at all by doing this.
bottom lane, though, reacting to Behemoth missing the Shockwave. Ran up, tried to go for a combo on a Silhouette right there with Parasite coming in, but actually, like I said, missed the Shockwave there.
Oh, this could be a Dead Rhapsody. If she walks in, she's dead.
They're going now. Now there is Prisoner coming, or Behemoth, excuse me, coming as well with Parasite. So Rhapsody, yes, you're right that she is dead, and actually Parasite realizing quickly they're not going to win.
He's
going to
block them off. Yeah, he's going to block them off. Yeah, good luck. Good luck. They saw the Invis here with the ward they have right on top, so they were aware that B had Invis. They dropped a rev, and they played up perfectly. So good rotation. And this is what I mean about Sulphorus. If you have to pull open, you pull these two camps together like you do with Legionnaire, and you just kill them with two Qs. So if you triple those two, so like if he stacked those two at the 2-minute mark, he would have had a double camp on both sides, right?
Yeah.
And then he does the same thing at 3 minutes while he's killing EC and medium, and then he has two triples to kill at the same time. And that's level 7 by 5 minutes.
It's pretty impressive when you actually watch a experienced jungler on this hero especially, that the difference. Because, you can definitely feel it. I mean, I know this game especially, yes, Parasite has been having a little bit of an impact, sure. But, we do see, it is struggling a little bit here. 270 GPM at 7 minutes plus does seem a little lower than it should be. And as you pointed out, we already noticed there's a couple of mistakes there, so... Not that it's, going to be game-breaking or going to be an absolute loss because of it, but...
No, but at the same time, he just started playing the hero, right? So we can't expect him to play it perfectly. And then you have to look at the fact, so do we care if our jungler isn't the best Sulphorus if we cannot pick up the hero? That's probably how they're thinking. We don't want ECX to have Sulphorus. We have the chance to get the hero, and we're going to take it, even though our jungler hasn't played it in 100 games.
Yeah, it's actually interesting you bring that up because... As we saw last game, both teams are kind of under that boat where neither What You Got or Tank of Fed are clearly the most experienced on it. So just happens to be that newer breed of jungler hero that's really, at that top tier now even. So, but gonna get that practice in, I'm sure, as time moves on here. Sustainer finish on Scout, by the way. So, his farm basically not hurt at all. 340 gold per minute now. Actually, he's second in the game behind his own teammate even in Prisoner in middle lane. So... overall pretty good for ECX here, but Silhouette is doing well herself. She did get the, as we see, the Soul Scream ring here first.
Yeah, probably just for a little bit of extra life or stats. I don't think she'll build into an Energizer. Jace is porting top. Smoked up Midas behind, might be a kill on Mirax. I hope they have Dust here. Oh no.
Do they not have Dust at all? They don't.
No, Glacius is running for it now, maybe? Or okay. And they have a Smoked Behemoth, so is this going to be a 3v3 up here in the top lane? And Midas was just spotted. Yeah, they just warded, so... if that ward wasn't there, that could have ended very badly.
Yep.
On the other hand, Meraxes might be in trouble now, because Cole doesn't have any vision, and if Bia runs up here and blocks him off, then Fusty might be dead.
See, Rhapsody is kind of going back and forth.
Yeah, they're thinking about it. But, no? Yes? No?
Get back here.
Now? Yeah,
now. Now would be a good time.
Now he's dead. Yeah, nice.
All right, there we go. There's a block. Awkward. Okay, he's going to end up shockwaving, and Parasite is here as well. But look at this, though. I mean, he gets a Matrix. You see the face up coming in his...
Oh, TP's.
Moraxis, he's going to be fine, and now he's going to try to chase back and perhaps get some kind of turn here. I don't think that's going to happen. Well, maybe on Parasite, actually. He has the Minotaur. He's going to be able to take that over. Stomp will
never
keep it
say
in
never,
place.
Bakey.
Freeze. There's the freeze, and now Tank of Fed's in a lot of trouble. Oh, but now Prisoner's coming, so it's just continuing here. Back and forth. There's only one hero not here, and it's Silhouette, actually. And I don't think she's porting in, honestly. And down it goes Lord Zalforce. Oh, the pull on Iglesias. He, too, is going to fall. And after the chase of back and forth, ECX actually gets a double tap out of it. Wow. That was something. I mean, like I said, though, Silhouette, the only one not to be here. She does push in the bottom tower at least. So, something there for Complexity.
Yeah, I think the TP reactions were very good, but as soon as Meraxes got out, they should have backed off. Because they didn't have vision of the other two heroes, so... They weren't aware if there were five, but then again, Sulphorus is crazy good in early clashes. You can't fight that hero. So I guess they maybe thought they could turn with it, but sadly he only got one Q off. So I'm not sure, but yeah, good fight for ECX regardless. It's a very even game, by the way, if you look at the numbers.
Yeah, it's continuing to be that way, now 11 minutes in, so. Well, wouldn't expect anything less here, being game three especially. These two teams are important on the line. So Stainer finished on Silhouette, so yeah, looks like she is getting that Null Stone now. Just one of the little bit early stats to work with here. Lord South Forest, gonna be about 300 after this camp right here. Yeah, gets up to that point, so he's starting to step up a little bit now. And continuing his work, still going the typical so far of the Blood Chalice Ghost Marchers. We'll see about what he goes next.
Mm-hmm.
Prisoner, did he fall? Yeah, the Midas looks like he hooked that in, but realized pretty quickly that that was just an illusion there. But he has a portal key now. Coming out to Prisoner.
I just got confirmation from Mickey, by the way, that Midas is supposed to beat Prisoner. But then he wrote that, but I don't know, when I'm playing on US East, US East hurts.
Okay. That's true.
But then again, it was Oscar is like, you know, yeah, it's the same thing. So.
Yeah. That's fair. Matthias, he's definitely doing work for ECX. Again, it continues to be actually the top. Well, not any longer. Silhouette is now taking over, of course. And actually, speaking of that.
Oh, okay, God.
Going to be seen right there. Splits up. Prison Break coming out, though. Pull in, forcing him to keep nearby. Look at this. By himself. That damage, man, from the one-man riot. He gets everything off. It's a lot of damage, actually.
And it's a 9-second W, and Silhouette can't swap for 9 seconds unless she kills the W. So what Farmos actually should have done there was turn around and kill the W and hope to be able to swap out after the ulti was over. And would have been able to do so, but would have died to Rhapsody. So it wouldn't have mattered, but still a good thing to think about.
Yeah, it's like, obviously, yeah, to kind of think about that on paper and everything, but in the moment, when you're going to jump like that on the fly, it can be difficult to react, but, you know, this level of play, you can argue you have to be able to do that. Midas, E2's going to fall. This portal key is doing work for Matthias. Yeah. Back-to-back kills already. Coming out. Oh, they lose the middle tower, but still. Getting the hero kill, pretty important right there. And he's 440 gold per minute. If you're Matthias here, if you're this prisoner, God, you know, I've brought this up in the past with Prisoner. It's never really happened. The idea of like an Insanitarius, you know, right click, that one man riders we're just talking about, pretty strong. If you're gonna get start like this, could that be like something where?
No, I think he needs to PK into Shunken straight away. But I actually do believe it's possible for sure. Like if you can get an early Insanitarius along with a Shunken hit eventually, like you hit so hard. So no, I definitely think it's good, but in a game like this when they're so far ahead and it's about scout really. He just got his cleaver by the way. Then I think he just goes for the Shunken, tries to lock down as many heroes as he can, and that's a smoke. Where? Mid lane. So he's gonna go for the Midas again, which he might find. No.
Midas running away already. So, I don't know if he saw something or just simply happened to be, you know, bottom rune. Yeah, 14-minute rune, they're going for it. Illusion picked up by Behemoth, though. So, the rune control, man, ECX, really just seems like they're on top of it. Getting most, if not all, the runes, so. Moraxis trying to find his farm bottom lane, trying to get that portal key himself. Top tower goes down, though, in the meantime. Parasite.
He missed ultimate.
Who's that? Prisoner?
Yeah, personally, oh, yeah, he blinked in, and same millisecond, Midas blinks out. Well, close enough.
Yeah, just in time. We'll play on his part there. We got Imba Boy, looks like he's going the same that he went before. In fact, also going to try to set something up here middle. Puts an electric eye down, so in case of not only vision, but...
Yeah, once again, he's... Limba's playing very aggressively, and he's probably going to block those after the ward is out or gets countered. And he does the same build. Red Boots into Abyssal, into Ghostmarches, I'm guessing.
He got the Abyssal Skull or the Ring of the Teacher, so yeah, the same one in case he missed it the first game. They also went Scout and did very well that game, so.
Good back. Yeah, no stone finish on Silhouette. And I guess we're both going to guess that it's going to be a PK straight after. I'm very interested to see what he's going to go after that, though. Like, because Nullfire could be a very interesting pickup here to remove the Scout Silence and also to perch off the W from Prisoner. You can still do that, right?
I don't
No? You should be able to do that. And it also works against puzzle blocks, obviously.
Yes.
But if he doesn't go Nullfire, then it should be a Geometer's Pain against Gale Silence regardless. So we should see a PK into Geometer's here, unless he wants to go Nullfire Blade.
Yeah. That would be a different trek there. I mean, you could also make the argument for the Hellborn team. Of course, Silhouette one of these heroes where Nullfire could be good against her of the illusion.
Yeah, no, for sure. I do expect us to see a kind of a similar build, though, because Wingbow is equally good this game on Scout. Wondering if he's going to go Shrunken earlier, though, considering he's playing against Alphorus and heroes like that. But I guess we'll find out. But it should be Abyssal into Ghost Marchers, and then... Well, Himbaboy is going to have to guide us the way, because I have no idea.
So Alphorus needs to be careful here top, and by that I mean he's dead. Yeah, they saw Rhapsody and Prisoner sitting there, and as soon as the blip on the map started going up, and what you got, pretty much knew that was over for him. Yeah, faded that very well. And again, this portal key, that's what you love to see. That initiator get the portal key earlier in the game and just make play after play after play with it.
This is one of those games where I just really feel for Love. It's the exact same situation Serenia was in yesterday, where he was Glacius and he couldn't do anything. Like, for an entire game, he literally just died to Sandwraith, and that was all he did.
Yeah.
My point here being that it's one of those games where you pick Glacius to counter the Parasite, because he's a decent hero against Parasites. You force them... Well, you ensure that they can't long lane on you. That's the main thing. If you have a Glacius on your team, the enemy team cannot aggressive trialing with a Parasite. Well, they can, but it's bad.
Yeah.
So, the problem is, though, that in a game like this, now Love just got his boots. Well, not just, but... Like, he only has boots, and he's going to die every team fight. And it's really sad, but it's kind of inevitable. Like, there's nothing they could have done differently, because their top lane went fine. Well, Imaboy still farmed, but, like, Love didn't feed. Like, there wasn't any mistakes being made. But I'm trying to wonder here, what is Love going to do now for the rest of the game? Because it's going to be really hard for him to make plays on a hero like this. And point being that same thing yesterday with my team, where Cormal wasn't able to do much. I think he ended on, like, 2-11-7 or something like that. And, yeah, it's just hard for him to do something. While Nier has a Dance Floor that will always have impact, the ultimate will eventually get impact as well. And I feel like that hero has more to it.
Unless you get the staff on Glacius.
Yeah, but... yeah, sure. mid lane?
Middle lane, yep. Behemoth, he's finding the opportunity. Scout is nearby.
Oh, this is so... If they go on Silhouette Solution?
Okay, she just swapped to this one now. They should probably know that that's fake now, obviously.
Yeah. The Whirling Blades isn't doing damage to the creeps, so that should be a thing enough.
Okay, they get the tower kill, despite several being there. The illusion being stunned there. They just want to make sure to kill it before they do remember to jump in with it. Rhapsody is going to be jumped there and quickly kill. But now here comes Scott as well as Behemoth. He's looking for an opportunity. Shockwave, no, they're not really grouped up right now, so he can't find it. Prisoner being chased down by Lords of Force back here. But he eventually finds something. They do get the quick kill on him or Axis. Parasite going in. Behemoth and Scott were running away, actually. So very greedy push here by Tankafed. And now he's going to be taken out of the mall there. But Prisoner's still around. They do pick off Glacius. Oh. The pull from Prisoner. Pull Silhouette away. By losing a teammate right there in Parasite, as Scout is sitting back on a Midas, but that Void Talisman and Silhouette being here. Scout, one more auto attack. Yes, it gets the kill onto him right there. Behemoth able to run away, it looks like, from South Forest, and he will be fine in the long run. But, yeah, pretty scattered fight there.
That was absolutely crazy scattering. They were so split, and they were fighting on all locations, and... A huge combo, though, from Oscar, that entire team fight. I think he got the initial combo, of course, then a second one, and then a third one that hit both Scout and the Parasite. So very, very well played team fight from Oscar there. And I'm looking here at the Hellborn team, and they don't actually have any hero that is... Well, they have Behemoth that is really good against Silhouette, but that's it. And then, well, Scout can be argued, but I don't think we have enough games of Scout to really know exactly how good it is.
Sure.
So I'm trying to. So it's kind of. It's actually a pretty good Silhouette game. Because for a Prisoner to be able to go in on the Silhouette and get his W off, it's very hard. So this Silhouette might be really hard for the Hellborn team to deal with if the game goes longer, unless Scout, because on paper it's good against it. So
yeah, no.
I'm not sure.
It has to. I mean, it has to be. This the disarm, the silence, you know, those two pretty strong abilities. We mentioned, though, you know, when Silhouette does get the Geometer's Bane, and especially that itself is going to really help prevent what Scout should be good against her for. And that is going to be coming up next, you would think. Does have the Quick Blades here. So once he gets that, I think that's where you can really start feeling comfortable for Complexity.
Yeah, Geo's a Nullfire for sure. Definitely.
Scout, 1,000 gold save up, doing some more Ancients himself. Again, they've been blocking the Legion Ancients as we've seen a couple of times here, but not as much as the first game, I want to say.
Well, what was it people did against Scout back in the days? Do you remember what you picked? Nothing special, right?
Like a Tundra, maybe, for efficient purposes, but...
I don't really recall, because when it was picked all the time by SG, like, it was usually picked against Parasite and Ophelia for the offlane eye, like, that you ruin their jungler kind-of-ish.
Yeah.
But I don't remember, like, in specific if there was any hero... He went Steamboost this game, by the way. Okay.
Oh, yeah, he does, yeah.
Guess he values the attack speed a little bit more.
Pestilence is an obvious, you know, somewhat to an Invis, but...
I mean, the only one who's picked Pestilence the last year is us, and we've lost all three games with it.
Yeah. So I don't think it was that. You know, I don't recall really anything being like, oh, they got a Scout, let's get this now.
Yeah, no, I don't recall either. Well, anyway.
You have to think about that, though, because Imavoy, UCX, making it clear that it's something that they like here lately, at least. Matches today now. Whether this one will be a victory, still yet to be determined. Top lane going down, though, for Complexity. See bottom tower, though, also falling a
fight.
Lot of TPs, though. Yeah, we're definitely going to have some kind of fight right here if ECX
Scout
sticks
I, though.
Is.
The Scout I'm... Oh, no, good.
Is killed, though, so yeah, that could have been deep, so they jumped into that. But here we go, Prisoner, Prison Break. Void Talisman still being used. Moraxis is going to be pulled in, but he's got that Matrax up. However, it's not enough, apparently, but Silhouette jumps in the background, going for the quick kill. Ain't going to be enough damage himself. He swapped out, I believe. Midas trying to follow, kill Scout. No, he cannot. So it's Moraxis and Glacius down. Nobody dead on the Hellborn side. As Scout manages to stay alive, Silhouette, her illusion's going to be picked off. Trying to maybe
that
get
was
swap
so
back
unfortunate.
In.
Yeah, like, he got a perfect combo on Oscar on the Scout, but Formless wasn't aware that he was going to hit the Scout. So instead of going in for the Scout, he went for the Rhapsody and thus didn't get a kill at all. But if he went for Scout and started the fight, Scout would have died, and that fight would have been completely different. So maybe a bit of miscommunication, or Oscar just didn't expect to hit both of them.
Yeah.
It could honestly have been, because they don't have an eye, right? It could be that he hit the Invis Scout, and you know it gets revealed by Midas if you hit the combo.
And then Formless,
yeah. And Formless was like, oh shit, I took the wrong target, and yeah. But I'm not sure. And really good Void Talisman pickup. I don't know if I said that earlier on Wig. I think that's really good this game. And another one on Midas, so I guess that's the way of dealing with Prisoner. Well, it is, obviously, but it's still a lot of gold. But I definitely agree with the Void Talisman on Sulphurus, and I guess it's good on Midas as well.
It's...
And it's...
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, he should pick up a Storm next. That's all.
Storm Spirit pretty good, too.
Yeah,
I mean, Prisoner has always been that here. We have seen a lot more Void Talismans. Prisoner is kind of that example of why, but I think with the Scout, too, they, again, there's a good argument that, especially if it does work like that, where if it's up and if Scout tries to silence you with his silence, if it actually would be immune, then there's even more value there out of it. But,
yeah
there's a good amount of physical threat here, so
I think that's for sure.
A good pickup for sure. No more to it, but Silhouette cleaning up a double stack engine, actually, so able to get that despite what's been happening in troubles from Scout, especially. That's good for the Legion side there. You do see Tank Effect doing what he does best, gets the puzzle blocks, has that Soul's Bulwark now. Loves the auras.
It's going to be so good with a Demonic on this team. Like, it should be an ally mode in this game for certain. Like, if he gets 7 armor to everyone in the team, along with the Abyssal, which is 2, 5, 3, 4? What is it? 5? 5, I think?
The Abyssal armor.
Wait, let me check. It's
five
aura effects, 5.
Yeah.
Okay, so 5 armor from Abyssal, 7 from Demonic, and then they might pick up... They don't have a Plated Greaves. Maybe we... I guess they're not going to buy a Plated Greaves for Sackstone. But point being, 12 armor against Silhouette is, of course, very good.
Yeah.
Like, that's going to be very hard for Formless to do a lot of damage, so he might have to pick up a mid-slash-late-game Harkon's Blade.
Yeah, oh, that would be interesting. Yeah, if they maybe had if they had a secondary carry that was a lot of physical threat too, then maybe you could argue they should also get the Plated Greaves Sackstone, but Yeah, I think 12 armor. Those two alone should be plenty here.
Yeah, for sure. Accomplished.
There's that middle tower going down in the meantime. Is that the last outer? Yes, it is. So all that our tower is destroyed by ECX now, and she's going right away to the Ancients. Another Ward of Scythe there blocking. Investing a lot. Bottom lane, by the way. Behemoth trying to get away now. Not going to happen, though. Silhouette.
No illusion.
She doesn't have an illusion. You're right. Prisoner. Oh, he's going to get the certain kill. And Iglesias there. So the real Silhouette, though, will escape because of that, at least. So ends up being a one for one. Silhouette now back to base. And the Geometer's Bane is one step closer to being finished here.
Scout's going to... No, never mind. Void Talisman.
Yep. Go,
oh, wait.
That's going to kill him. Yeah.
Jesus.
That's where Void might not be good against Scout. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah, that ulti deals so much damage, and then plus a Void Talisman? That's crazy. Damn.
It was half-life to dead through that ultimate, so. Yeah.
But, couldn't he have blinked, or was he silenced? I didn't see.
He definitely wasn't silence. See, it might have still been on cooldown because obviously he is opened on with some auto attack. So,
maybe okay. Yeah.
It's only a couple seconds, really. Yeah, the channel time of that level 3 is what 1.25 seconds. So, it's not.
Yeah, it's very fast.
Yeah. Rhapsody and Behemoth working towards the bottom here. Ward of Sight. Yeah, I definitely saw them heading here. So Silhouette knows that something may be happening. Oh, it's the illusion now.
Man, they're doing such a good job with this. Oh, he's going Harkons on Scout. I really like that. That is so good. Like, he's gonna, like, wreck this Midas in Sulphurus. Because he has a Shrunken, and he's gonna deal, like, 250, 260 damage per auto attack. And he does 4 auto attacks in, what, 1.5 seconds? That's crazy. He's gonna hit true damage on 2 of their heroes on Legion.
That's interesting.
I really like this pickup.
Well, like... So if you see this Archon now, when they see it, even with the Arcana, you can almost go to expect it, perhaps. I'll get through it in a second, because here we go with the bottom push. The tower, it's dropping pretty quickly. Prisoner, yes, he lands the hook on what you got. He just got a Frost of Skull, so he's actually pretty tanky, though. Scout going to be cut off by a Fissure there, as Meraxis, and Scout's dropping really quick. He's going to go down with that token. They do pick off South Forest despite that. As Silhouette, that's now the illusion. Able to swap back in, so they get the token used. Self-Force died, but not too bad right there. They might be able to hold this ultimately. They are going to lose a tower. Let's save the Rags is the question. Another lead hook by Matthias. He is on point here. Fuzzy Sloth, he's trying to stay alive here with that Maechuk Beam. It's just like, nah, I'm going to finish you. Goes in with a Shockwave, secures the kill. And now Meraxis is dead. Now he can buy back, despite Sulphurus not being able to, and he will right there. They want to save these melee racks. Definitely don't want to give it up. Shurken has been used Transmute on a Parasite, but zero follow-up, really. Silhouette not really comfortable enough just yet. She doesn't have her illusion, so she has to be very cautious. Meraxis is going to be pulled back in, though, and he once again will go down. So they're doing everything they can to stop the melee racks to go down. Even Love using the Glacial Downpour. He's going to die because of that, though, and the racks will eventually fall right here. So ECX. Quite the grind here at the bottom to finally push in the racks, but they make it happen. And actually, wow, that was a very aggressive blink there by Matthias.
Going the sheepstick here, by the way. And to answer, what? Never mind. More action.
They're going back in now. Mine is coming back. Particularity. It will save a little bit of damage on the Scout right there, but now Scout's being locked down. He's in trouble. The Undying is on him, and he is going to die because of that. Going to chase him down right there, guaranteed. Rhapsody will be able to port out successfully, though, with no stuns, as does Behemoth. But Tankafet picked off to the side. Double tap for Formless, and so Complexity, they do at least get a little bit of victory there at the end of the fight. But ECX got what they came for in the racks. Whew, that took a while there.
Yeah, that was a very intense fight. Okay, so now to answer your question before the fight started. They still got to keep your Void Talismans against Prisoner, because I believe that was your question.
That was where I was going, yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, they still got to keep them because it's so good against Prisoner. And they're just going to have to be far enough away to not get hit by the Scout when it happens, or just make sure that they're positioned properly. So that is my opinion, at least. And when they respawn, by the way, they're going to have Demonic almost finished on Parasite. Sheep is 2k off, or a little bit less, actually. A little bit less, 1k, 1.5k. And we are 200 off from the Harkons on Imbaboy, because I believe he bought the recipe before. So, yeah, no, they're looking very good on their items. I guess Pulse will be picked up here by Sane as well. And, no, game is still looking good for ECX, but that was a little bit of a overcommitment, to say the least.
Yeah, I was a little surprised they kept going after that fact. With how big of a grind that was at the bottom, and finally they played it so well, figured that would have been the time to fall back. But they tried for a little bit more, and clearly was the wrong choice there. But, again, still ultimately coming out with the victory there. Giving Complexity a little bit of leeway at the end of it. But yeah, that Harkon, this has got to be one of the earlier Harkons we've ever seen, honestly. Like, Harkon seems like one of those items that's like, it's a very late game reaction to, you know what, they have a lot of armor, we need to get the Harkons on our carry to actually be able to do damage. And, you know, we've seen it in those cases, but really never for this matter.
It's definitely a reaction on the two White Talismans. Like, he feels like, well, my job is just to kill the target we're going for, and I can't kill two heroes at my current rate, so I need that Harkon so I can kill those two heroes.
Yeah,
I don't think he would have picked it up otherwise.
That is interesting. So we'll see how that works for Imba Boy here. Looks like ECX good to go. Matter of Complexity being ready. It's definitely all three of these games, no doubt, having strat pauses, unless they just have the smallest bladders ever and they keep using the restroom. But no,
well, I mean, This could have been a strat pause. It also couldn't. The other two were kind of obvious, but this one was just a pause after the fight happened. So, but it could still be.
True.
If it is, it's good because they need to talk about what they're going to do now for the rest of the game because they're still in a heavy disadvantage. And ECX play here is to finish Demonic, finish Sheep, finish Harkons, get Conger, go high ground, and what are they going to do? So do they want to wait for that and hope that they can win a fight in the base, or do they want to try to smoke out and try and make plays on them before they get their items?
What do you think of the Necrosis Skull, by the way?
And very nice.
Yeah, it's very nice. That seems like that's the overall. That's like one of the items that across the board everyone just loves now.
Okay, so to answer your question, I hate it because Frostfield Plate is out of the game.
Okay.
But I love the item in itself.
Yeah.
Because Frostfield is gone, I think the item is great. I think it's very good. It has a lot of uses for different roles, different players, and different heroes. But I hate the fact that you removed Frostfield Plate.
What about then the quote-unquote replacement for Frostfield, the Ultors?
Oh, no, that's why Frostwolf is great. Oh, sorry. Oh, you mean the Ultors.
Ultors, heavy play.
Yeah, no. No.
No? No.
I just did an item review on my YouTube for it. Yeah,
people should check that out then. Well, where can they check that out, Slapped?
YouTube.com/BSlapped, actually.
Bees
so
left.
That's yeah, and my latest item review there has Ultra's heavy plate in it, where you can get my insight on the item.
Left. All right.
No, I personally don't see it picked up on more than there's like 5 to 10 heroes that I count up, but mostly on Salomon. Like, we got absolutely wrecked by Formless when he bought it, because it removed Pestilence. We had Pestilence that game, my silhouette, and it removes Pestilence Ultimate. Then he had a Shrunken that also removes Pestilence Ultimate, and yes. 100 armor for 6 seconds. Well, decreasing, but still. So I don't like the item because it's very limited into what heroes is going to be picked on, and I really only see it being incredibly good on Salomon. And Salomon is.
Yeah. And Salomon's most pretty powerful.
Yeah, bro, he's broken and he's going to get nerfed. So no, I wish to have Frostfield back, but I'm really glad that we still have as good of an item as Frostwolf to have a semi replacement on the item.
Okay. Yeah, just checking it out here. You got several item reviews. Okay. Gotta go there for your full insight on the items.
Yep.
Check that out. Voltstone, yeah.
Oh, yeah, talk about Voltstone and Friendly Claw as well. Yeah. And then I have
Spiked Bola is one I'm actually looking forward to seeing for the first time. I think there's a little bit of value that people aren't picking up on there with that. I understand the build-up of it's awkward.
No, as I said, the only way for it to be viable is if it goes through Shrunken Nut. So it can be not, it gets dispelled by Shrunken, but you can apply it on a Shrunken head of target. And then the item is fine.
Does
it's
it not
balanced,
do that? I thought it did.
Good. No.
Oh, no, really? It is just straight up magic.
It's straight up magic, and you can apply it to a Shrunken head of target. And why would you ever buy it then? Because 90% of carries nowadays goes Shrunken.
That's
just not viable.
Yeah, no, I'm with you there. Yeah, I didn't realize. I figured you could dispel it off, but you could still use it. But no, that makes sense then.
Yep.
All right. Middle
tower. It was definitely a strat pause, by the way. Yeah, it was a strat pause. They just straight up run four heroes mid. They're like, we have 30 seconds. Let's try and get an objective. And boom, they're on there. Well, Lone pushes out of bottom alone. It's no good. We'll see if they can backdoor top or if they're going to go... I wonder if so it's... Is that a shield breaker or a shrunk? It has to be a shrunken, right?
But, I mean, shield breaker is really good on Silhouette. It's been a popular item on here, so...
Yeah, but they have a lot of magic on Hellborn. You can purge things off with shrunken and the Harkons won't work. Huh. So I would say it's a shrunken, but either way, I guess it's fine.
Yeah, if they picked up that he's going Harkons, which, again, you would have to assume that they saw the Arcana. Yes, that makes other items, but the realistic one here would be the Harkons. So, yeah, that's probably more reason for it. And actually, oh, he's in trouble. Silence, does he have an illusion up? He does. Oh my gosh, he could not get it off. Thought he had a very split second there. But he did not. So nice catch, though, and that's a streak stopper, too, actually. Emma Boy getting credit for 600 plus gold there. Bonus, so.
Yeah, that's nice. That's his Harkons that he's sending out right now.
Yeah. That's important.
And another Gnomes on Raps, like ECX, holy. I'm 100% certain they've sat down in Skype and said, this is how we're going to buy our items every game.
Yeah.
Because there's not one game I have seen them not buy every single team item there is.
They make sure of it, yeah.
Yeah, it's good. It's really nice. That's how they're supposed to do it.
Yeah, no, Nier's made the point, too. He loves the Gnomes Wizard. I've had that obviously as a co-caster several times, and he thinks that's great now, especially with the changes. So
he's the best co-caster there is right now.
Well, there you go.
From players playing the game.
He's fun to have on. If you were on more, I mean, there might be a challenge there, right?
I think Nier's better. I'm a little bit biased.
So humble. No, it's fine. I like what we got going. A plethora of casters. We're having some fun with that. Demonic breastplate. Sheepstick on Midas. Yeah. Demonic is coming on Parasite.
They're just waiting for Conquer now, and then they will be ready.
And that sheep on Prisoner. Think would have to be soon here. How about the spell shards on Behemoth?
What does that item cost?
Oh, 16,
no, 6, no, 1325. I have no idea. I'm guessing he's missing 325 for, well, 300 for the weird-ass item.
Perpetual Cogwheel, yeah.
Yeah, that's an interesting name. Perpetual Cogwheel. Yeah, oh. All right, you said spell shards? I'm never a fan of that. Much rather see a Storm or Arrested Stone. I really dislike spell shards, but Siba does it every now and then, and every time I say no. But he does it anyway, so. It has its uses. It's good, but I just think there's better items.
Is there an item in the game that reduces cooldown of abilities? I don't think there is now, is it? Because I know spell shards used to do that. There was that.
Yeah, old spell shards, but no, I don't think there is. I'm really looking forward to if. Well, I believed that they would implement that mechanic again with the item revamp, but they didn't. So.
We don't know. 2,800 gold on South Forest, pushing out the bottom, keeping that in check down there. And also, it's a nice farm out of it. So, yeah, you mentioned Congor, do that, and then probably look to try to siege and ultimately end the game. And sure enough, here we go. Congor being attempted. Should be a pretty quick kill once again for ECX. Doesn't look like Complexity any contesting here.
No, there's nothing they can do about it, really. They just need a Congor and then go straight up mid. This plus 12 armor is going to be insane. But it's still, like, Abyssal and that still doesn't stack, right? No, it doesn't.
No.
Just...
You still get a magic armor benefit, though, from the gnome, so...
Yeah, of course.
Still worth it, you could say. Now, at least. Then the eventual Jade Spire on Rhapsody. Probably not going to see that.
Nah, probably not.
There's the Shrunken.
Still a very good item. Yeah, Shrunken? Yep.
Almost.
I wonder who or what they're going to prio here in Cole. Like, what heroes are they going to go for first? I'm not sure. It's going to be interesting to see how Cole takes these team fights here. They need a Demonic here on Sulphurus now. Like, they're lacking in team items in general, and... If they don't start buying team items soon, they're just going to lose hands down because of the 5 team items on Hellborn.
Oh, middle lane. Silhouette jump, but he had the support nearby. They're going to try to make a turn happen right here. Silhouette, though, is just too much damage. Never mind.
Oh, no.
I thought
no
Blur
buyback.
Was coming, actually. And no buyback. You're right. If they saw that Shuriken, they probably are picking up on that, too. Moraxis running away. Just see that damage, though, with the Harkons coming out. Just tearing through. Pullback in from Matthias. Scout's getting low, actually. Protected. Melody will barely keep him alive. Now, again, he has a token. So the Undying is going to kill him in the end. Well, they tried. So he is going to come back up, though, with full life and full mana. But, yeah, no buyback on anyone. Moraxis does. But all he would have is just an Initiation Stomp. But you can argue he probably has to here. I mean, the game's honestly probably over if he doesn't.
Yeah, there should be Mega Creeps. There should be Mega Creeps.
Oh, are they going for the Throne or Megas? It looks like they are going to go for Megas. A little indecisive there, but they're going to go for the Mega. So, yeah, no buyback on Moraxis. He's going to wait it out, actually. Or at least wait for the better spot. Prisoner, though, keeping them busy while the rest just take them out, and it will be Mega Creeps. I think Ultimate are going to give it up, so Complexity, it's either Concede or One Last Stand. They say GG, well played. Evil Corporation will be taking the victory here, and that means they're going up against, well, you guys, Sync Esports in the Grand Finals. Coming up next here on Honkcast. So Complexity, they finished third. You're in Cycle 7. I know there's a little bit of a smile on your face.
Yes, there is right now.
That helps.
I still got to win. But if we win, we are actually going to be tied on points, if I'm not wrong, with Complexity, which is just a dream coming true, because that just means that we can be 7th place as long as Complexity is 8th place. So
you
that's
are
great.
500 points behind right now, and if you get first place, you would actually be 200 points ahead.
Yeah, even that.
Complexity.
There we go.
So.
Yeah. Ah. Good stuff, ECX, but I still got to beat ECX, you know. So I'm actually going to have to leave it right here because I need to do
all
some
right.
things with my team. So, but thank you for having me on CoCasting, dude.
Any shout-outs before you go?
Well, shout-out to my team and shout-out to everyone watching. We have a lot of viewers today. It's awesome. And, thanks for having me on. It's
good
been
luck.
Fun.
Thank you for joining me. We'll be watching, of course.
Thank you. Yeah. Goodbye.
See ya. All right, guys. So with that said, obviously Zlap taking off there. He's got that whole match to play now. He's got the Grand Finals, and it is going to be against Evil Corporation coming up. But, yeah, as we were just talking about there, again, I'm even looking over the standings and everything. And so here's a quick breakdown of how the points look in terms of what you earn for what places you finish in. So as we're talking about right now, Complexity is 500 points ahead of Sync Esports. So Complexity finishing in third place, that gets them 2,000 points. But as you see, either Sync is finishing first or second now. They'll only get 300 points difference this cycle, which would put them at 200 points under, or they'll be getting 700 points difference this cycle, which would put them 200 points over Complexity going into the next cycle. So getting first place is still very important right now for Sync Esports, because then they truly would control their own destiny. However, if they do finish second, then Complexity will still be in the overall lead, and it will then just absolutely straight up come down to whoever finishes better in the next cycle, pretty much. So this is important. Again, Complexity not winning here hurts them a little bit more than just simply finishing third place for their share of the prize pool in the big scheme of things. And as we're stressing this, because first place team –